Hey, I'm Immortal Mage, and welcome back with another tutorial for Prism Sequencer. Today, we're going to be taking a look at chord blocks. Chord blocks are Prism's way of handling chord progressions. It's a suite of tools designed to help you create and craft your own harmonies, you know, chords, and ultimately your own progressions by interrelating those chords together and creating something interesting out of it. Now, there's a whole lot to these blocks, so let's just dive right in and we'll work our way through them. So I already have Prism opened and I am going to, well, I both have it opened and I have it tuned to a tonal track. Right now my keypad's just standard mode, playing all the notes. It's connected with my MiniLog XD over here. That's where the sound's coming from. So to turn on chord blocks, we're gonna press and hold the graphic, the keypad octave graphic, and that gives us the keypad settings. We'll then select chord blocks. Immediately, you'll see that the keypad has changed to give us the chords, the blocks that we have available. So the way that this works is you get 8 blocks, and these are 8 blocks shared across all 16 tracks. You can then fill these 8 blocks with any 8 notes, and those are basically your 8 chords. So then you create your chord progressions based on those blocks. The fun part is that you can then go back and edit the block, and anywhere you've laid out that block or that chord in a sequence across any of the 16 tracks and any of the patterns will immediately update to match the new contents of the block. So those are the 8 keys we have down here, and we can hear the chords when I press them. By default, Prism comes with like C to B, you know, just a kind of standard major chordal range. On the top 4 keys, these pink, they allowed us to trade what I call a stack. So 8 blocks makes a stack, or basically like the inputs to your progression, meaning that these 4 keypads up here mean that we have 4 stacks and we have access to 4 different chord progressions. Currently, they'll all play the exact same thing as they load with the standard defaults. But as we go and edit them, you'll be able to see, you'll see that one chord stack will change from another chord stack, and then we can switch between those chord stacks throughout our songs by tying them to the scenes. So that way we could have, you know, the exact same pattern playing 2 completely different like chord contents by just changing the stacks that's being, or the stack that's being referenced. Okay, that's a lot of explanation. Let's get back into how does this work. So again, we've got our lower 8, which is just, you know, each of these blocks. So I'm going to select this G block and I'm going to lay down some notes on the sequence. Sequencer. Yeah, that's right. All right, nothing fancy. I'm not really even thinking about this musically. But you can see now I've got, what, 6 G blocks, and I'll play those. There we go. I selected all the notes and pulled them in to bring the length down to 1/32nd step so we could hear that. So right off the bat, we've got some chords put in place. Let's look at how we can edit those. We have 2 ways to edit them. The first is by accessing the notes via the trigs, and the second is via the keypads. Accessing them through the keypad is going to be our main mode. So let's just take a look at the trigs really quickly. As always, we can press and hold a trig and we get access to the trig focus mode. When a chord block is loaded into a trig, the notes that are in that block are highlighted in white. Now, you can still add other notes on top of the block into the trig. These notes will be added as green trigs. If I press and hold, I can add and remove a note from the block directly. So the big difference here is if I add a note or remove a note from the block contents, so if it's a white keypad, then it's going to change the block itself, which changes the value for all the notes I've laid down. So we can hear that. Whoops. You can see that. So that's how that referencing works. At any point, if I change the contents of the blocks, every placement of that block on any trig will always change to update it. Another thing I can do though is I can add non-block contents. So now I've just changed the values of this trig while the other trigs will still just play the block. Easy enough. So that's one way that we can, that's how we can add trigs to the sequence and then update them using the trigs themselves. The sequencer works exactly the same as it would with any tone sequencer. There's no change to that. So then let's take a look at the second mode we have for editing blocks using the keypad. There's a whole lot more going on here, so pay close attention. The very first thing you need to know is how to access the basically chord focus mode. And you can do that by pressing and holding the trigger. Now you'll see it looks a whole lot like the focus trig menu, including access to this lock button up here. You can just touch and hold for quick access, but by locking it, you get access to a host of other features that are meant to help you compare chords together and design and craft them with relationship to each other instead of as complete individuals. And now you might be asking, wait, what does that look like? Actually, let's get back to that in a sec. First, let's cover the things that we already know and that we need to know. How do we remove the notes from the blocks and how do we edit them? So you'll see that we have a completely different sequencer and a different graphic and a different keypad when we enter this chord edit mode. The keypad, these eight are still our chords. By touching any chord, we change and set the active chord block that we're editing. These eight pads up here show the individual notes of the chord. Right now, I only have four notes in each block, so I'm just seeing four. I can select any of these to gain access to it, to just that note. Once I've selected a specific note, I can shift it up, I can shift it down, I can shift it up an octave, down an octave, or I can remove it. To do the shifts, I can use either of these arrows over here. And if I press and hold these buttons, I can raise and lower it an octave. If I have the entire block selected and all of the notes, the arrows will still work the same way. They'll just affect the entire block. So I can raise the whole thing up and down and up an octave and down an octave. I can also clear the entire grid or a specific note by using this trash bin down here. So that's how I can edit notes using the graphic and the keypad. The sequencer is set up to also represent the notes in a different way. The lower eight pads or the lower eight trigs show the range of notes in our scale. So I'm working at a C scale, so I've got C through C. The top notes represent the octaves. So basically it's a way to say, hey, here are the scale points, the scale notes that I want in this chord. And then I want to add these layers to make it bigger. And those octaves are those layers. So if I select my A scale index, I already have one note added at the first octave, but I can add a note at the third and the fourth. I can press and hold to remove any note. I can press the lower index to select the overall grid again. And I can press again to select, if I had multiple, all of the notes. Again, once I have them selected, I can shift them up and down. So this is a way that you can say, oh, I like that tone. I'm going to keep that tone for two of the four of the notes in this chord. But for the next chord, maybe I would, copy this one. I can go here. I can paste. I can select A. And maybe I move that up to a G. But that's one way that you can then go in and instead of just grabbing a specific note, you can grab, a note type and do a aggregated transformation on top of that. The other way that you have to transform your chords without specifically editing them is through this random button right here. It's got two modes. The first, let's go to a fresh block. By tapping it, it'll remix and give us a new interval. So it keeps the exact same notes that we had, put in place, and it tries to keep the same octave range that we've set them up, but it'll flip them around. So instead of having, instead of having a D on top, now we've got F on top, and so on and so forth. So it's really just taking the notes and flipping them, inverting them in that way. But you'll get, different top notes and different bottom notes, and especially if you're using the play and the fuse modes to steal specific notes and you're directing that based on where they lie in the chord range, you'll get a pretty dramatic impact or a change across, all of the tracks. it's a really handy way to, it's a really powerful tool for evolving your chords without actually changing the tone. So then the second feature that we have on our remix is we can press and hold to completely remix the block. So I say completely remix, really it's the same as the interval, but now we can change the note values themselves. It still keeps the same notes and it still ties them in within the same range that the starting block was set up as. So we can go through and we can remix as much as we want. And maybe we decide, hey, we didn't want to remix at all. And if we press this button up here, we can go back to home. The way home works is it goes back to what we had loaded when we set that block to active. So I'll set this block to active and notice we have a D, E, E, B. So now we've got a B, E, D, E. I'll switch that. And now we go back to the deep. But watch what happens now if I say like we're at deep and I'm gonna go remix and then I'll go out and in. I can't go back to deep because it's reset the home note based on the fact that I re-entered the active note. So that's a really handy way though, if say like you have a note that you do like and you're using this first block as a root for a lot of things, you can create some intervals, you can copy that interval, you can go back and then you can paste the interval over here. And that's one way that you can start to, you know, add blocks on top of your chord progressions. The final button on here that's worth pointing out is this sample button. It's located all over the place. I use it pretty regularly. And really it just means, hey, while you're in this focus mode, it'll play chords. And you can hear that what's playing is also updated as I transform the block itself. So you can have that playing and you can kind of just bounce back and forth and edit all of these chords until you're almost drumming at them and they all sound and mesh together really well. I also lie. There is one other huge thing that I have to show off, and that's what if I want to look at the chord contents of one block, you know, build my other block while looking at those? You can use this watch button. While you're in this lock focus mode, the watch button will display the last three chord blocks that you've selected. So, you know, if I select a new one, it's switching that up. You can also, so it selects those three, but the one being edited is still the one that's highlighted and the one at top with the buttons next to it. You can't actually edit the ones that you're viewing. However, you can touch the graphic to set them as the active block. So now I can edit this block. And we can, you know, remove that, and maybe I'll add a G note. And I can do whatever, maybe I clear the whole thing and I'm just gonna make it a simple one and add. Yeah. There's really multiple workflows to navigating this chord block menu based on, you know, if you're right-handed or left-handed, if you're using an iPad or an iPhone, how you think about chords, are they about intervals or are they about the shape and how they relate to each other? I tried to look at what are all the various ways that you can look at the relationship between two notes and edit that relationship, and how many of those ways can I introduce and implement in an organic feeling way into this device so that you, the musician, can just tune into whichever makes the most sense for you. So we would go through, and this has been pretty messy so far. I don't think these chords are going to go together very well. But let's say, and I can press the lock or that, or sequence to exit the blocks. That's how you get out of the block mode. But anyways, let's say I did set it all up and now I want to do something like save it for next time. So if you press the stack that you're in and press the camera button, it will open up the block save menu. And so then I can go in and I can save this as test blocks. And now that's saved. So I can go to another one and I'm gonna use this stack. And I'm also gonna highlight and show you guys. So while I'm in this stack, That's what my G is. And this is what my G is. So listen to what happens when I play and switch stacks. So you can hear as I switch the stacks, the blocks update to play the notes contained via the stack, via the block that's contained in the active stack. So that means I can go to these stacks and I can press and hold and press the load button. And now I can load the test blocks that I just saved, or I can load any other stacks. And Prism comes with, it looks like, 7 or 8 default stacks set up. But you can add as many as you want. You can delete these ones. Feel free to do what you want. So I'll take that one and load it. And you can see now we have this G note. This 8th block is filled, which I hadn't done anything with before. And that is your block. So now I can go in and I can, you know, maybe create a really simple 4 bars. Perfect. And boom. I'll turn on this drum pattern I made, and that's, you know, in a very long-winded way with a whole lot of features and not a lot of music, that's how you use chord blocks in its entirety. We can tie these stacks to scenes. So, different chords. New chords now, playing on a different stack. And the chord blocks, of course, work the exact same way that any sequence does, so you can still use all the fuse, the arp, and the hue transformations on top of it to add variation. You can go in, you know, and you can create like other tracks and use the mix mode to add rhythm. I guess related to the chords, you have a chord mode in your arp, which is a really helpful way to go through and add rhythm once you've constructed your chords. I think that's about it. You know, there's probably some other stuff there that I missed. It's hard to hit everything with these. I know there's a settings menu attached to it. Yeah, you have the, oh, okay. The final thing to show off in chord blocks before we all get out of here is this sequence to block converter. So you don't have to start with blocks. If you go in and say you're just playing with like the chord multi mode, and you set up a sequence you like, you can go to blocks and you can convert that. And so now each of the blocks will represent the 3 notes I've laid out, and it converts the tricks themselves into blocks. So that's one way that you can go in and out of the block mode. And now you can access all the cool and interesting editing features and stack features and the save features that come with the blocks exclusively. Check out my little agenda over here, make sure we hit everything. All right, yeah, I think that's good. That'll cover it. So if you stuck around that whole time, thanks. If you didn't and you're like, that was too long-winded, I just have a few questions, shoot them below, happy to help. Yeah, always trying to make this better, make this more interesting. I hope you guys have fun creating. And until next time, I'll see you from the other side of the ether. Have a good day.